Well, the war changed the White House in many ways, but also made the White House a freer place in a certain respect because of the candor and the bombastic, larger-than-life personalities who came to camp out. And to me, one of the things that's so remarkable about it is if you think about Pearl Harbor Day, it's Eleanor whose voice the country hears first because the president is meeting with the cabinet, the war cabinet. And Steve Early, the president's press secretary, is giving out press releases and meeting with the press. It's Eleanor who is in the White House, walks out, hears all of the furor that the bombing introduced, and ends up walking out of the White House, walking across Lafayette Park, and then going walking across Pennsylvania Avenue, and then going into Blair House to broadcast, to tell the American people what had happened, what the president was doing, and to encourage them to, especially women and young people, to confront this unimaginable attack with a courage that she knew they had. And so her description of the wartime White House after Pearl Harbor is the best we've got. Now let's flip to the let's say, the somewhat comical side. Winston Churchill was character in many ways, and he was at just as large off-screen as he was on-screen. And when he came to the White House, he was a force to be reckoned with in terms of who could wait on him, what type of food he wanted, how much brandy he drank. And so it was Eleanor's obligation to sort of keep the White House staff happy and at the same time meet to the extent that she thought proper the Prime Minister's insistent demands. And so the day he first arrives in Washington, FDR's got a cold. Churchill comes in, he takes a bath, he takes a nap, he drinks a lot of brandy, he takes a nap, after he gets up to meet with FDR, and it's very late at night. And about 1:30 in the morning, Eleanor's walking down the hallway in the White House, getting ready to go to bed to do her mail, because she would answer the hundreds of letters that she got every night when everybody else was asleep. And she saw the president's light on, and she was a little miffed that the prime minister had kept the president up so late when the president wasn't feeling well. And so the next morning she's having breakfast with FDR, and she's giving him a little grief, and she says, well, you know, Franklin, you know, why were you up so late with Winston? And he's trying to diffuse it, and he turns to her and he says, well, you know, well, what were you doing up? And she says, well, I was doing my mail, of course. And then the president couldn't say anything because she caught him. And so it was when Churchill came, he governed the White House. He governed the brandy supply. He governed the staff's schedule about who could be on his floor when. He governed the president's schedule in terms of when the president could go to bed, in terms trying to really push on his part to develop a close relationship with FDR. Because when Churchill came to the White House the first time, the only memory that Churchill had of Roosevelt and Roosevelt had of Churchill were that they didn't like each other, and they were not very flattering memories of both of them. So a lot of that visit is a delicate dance to say, you know, I'm not the young arrogant jerk that I was when you met me, Winston. And Winston will say, Mr. President, I am not the insufferable prig who drank too much, who knew everything when you met me. And so there's this dance that's going on. And in the process, they become very dear friends. And one of the great lines of all time that comes out of this is Eleanor is walking down the hall one night, and she writes her daughter that she says, she's talking about the visit, and she says, Pa and the Prime Minister are like two boys playing soldier in the map room, because they're leaned over on the map room moving all of these little boats and tanks and cutout figures that that we now think of children, you know, using as little play toys.